But first, we start this week the way we start every week on the Intercut. Art, what you been watching?
You know what it is. One of the, what some may consider a perfect trilogy. To put it amongst all the other trilogies that are out there. And remember, a perfect trilogy in movies.
Using the P word.
Perfect doesn't mean that it's flawless. Perfect means that you embrace all of it. And I think Planet of the Apes is one of those. We were talking about our boy Matt Reeves just the other day. Yeah. And this is a man who I truly believe knows how to craft a story. This is a man who I think with this third one. And did he do the first one? I forgot to check that up. I can't remember if he did the first one or not. I know he did Dawn. I know he did this. He's done, if I'm not mistaken, Cloverfield, which near and dear to my heart. He did Let the Right One In, or
he did the American remake, Let Me In. But no, he didn't do Rise of the Planet of the Apes. He took over at Dawn.
Who did Rise?
It's Rupert Wyatt.
Good guy.
Yeah. He's gone on to do The Gambler, that Mark Wahlberg movie.
Okay.
He's not Matt Reeves. Matt Reeves is a stock you want to buy in.
As I was going home, I realized, you know what? He is underappreciated. Matt, what's the bad Matt Reeves film?
I mean, yeah, we talked about this a little bit last week when you tried to get me to buy into his Batman trilogy. Look, there's lots of people out there who don't like Cloverfield, but it is iconic and aside from just its campaign, is a very memorable movie that I think is significantly influential on horror movies that we've had in the last 15 years. But even a movie like Let Me In, where so many American remakes of foreign films are lambasted, even though people don't say that Let Me In is as good as Let the Right One In, they say it's close. I know Amy Nicholson thinks it's better, even. So this is a dude who's really great at finding the material in these different properties, whether it's a horror movie or a more intimate story. It's these action epics for the Apes trilogy. So I take it you did like War for the Planet of the Apes.
Boy, let me get to the moment I finished watching this movie. I was like, this is a biblical epic. It is a modern biblical epic. And
you tweeted
as
that
I always
much.
Do, I love watching interviews. And what's the first thing I hear Matt Reeves call it himself? Biblical. We were striving to make a biblical epic. And I'm like, look at it. It's the perfect conclusion to the trilogy. I think a lot of people, I think the key to a great trilogy is when you look at all three movies and you consider them one. Almost every fan that I know of the Rings trilogies always says, I see them as a complete whole. And I honestly see the Planet of the Apes, and it's crazy because it's prequels.
Right.
I don't like that P word, prequels. I never think of this as a prequel. I think of this as a history lesson,
right?
If anything, because this is the history of the Planet of the Apes.
Yeah, I mean, there's sort of like a assumption with a prequel that it's like somehow lesser than, because it's, you know, filling in the gaps of the thing that's really good.
Kinda.
This is its own thing. It's almost a disservice to say, oh, it's just the prequels to the
Planet of the Apes. Yeah. It truly is a historical lesson of what then becomes the Planet of the Apes that we knew from the old five movies. But even more so than that, what I'm saying, it's a biblical epic. Before I even describe why, literally at the end of the movie, without spoiling or anything, it is edited. The editing is completely different. And if you've seen Ben-Hur, if you've seen The Ten Commandments, it is edited like those movies. It is shot like those movies. It is drastically different in those final 10 minutes. And if you see it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But just in its story, I'm talking about like, when the first one is Rise, it literally is. Look at it. You know how they always show you those charts. If you've gone film school, if you've seen a YouTube video on it, you know it goes, you know, the rising action, the climax, the conclusion. That is exactly what Rise is. That is exactly what Dawn is. And that is exactly what War is. The conclusion of this arc for Caesar. And I honestly see them as a whole. For me, that goes Dawn, it goes War, and then it goes Rise. And that's not to say that any of these are bad. It's just the way that they come in. If Dawn is supposed to be the climax, it should be the best one.
Right.
If the one is the resolution, that you know, the final one being the resolution, it goes that way, and then Rise, and it's perfect in the sense of you usually have a movie with substance, forgetting about the entertainment factor, and you have those movies that are entertainment, the big blockbusters, that forget about the substance part. And you and I have talked about this in the past, that This is the perfect mix. When you have a movie that's like trying to get super emotional, trying to get really into the character side of things, it's usually an indie film, right? And mm-hmm. the indie films don't look the greatest, and you can tell that it was on a very limited budget. And then when you get something like Transformers, which we all know what Transformers is, but they look amazing.
Yeah.
But like, you're sacrificing in order for it to look incredibly amazing. That's all you're getting. Planet of the Apes. I have said this multiple times. You have said this. Some have argued that it should be Oscar material in the way that these apes look more real than the humans that are in there.
And their stories feel more real than some of the humans that are in there. You sympathize and empathize. Yeah, you get a full understanding of who these people, these apes are in this struggle. It doesn't necessarily... I think a lot of times in movies that are about warring factions, it kind of takes the simpler route of these people are good, these people are evil. And with a movie like Planet of the Apes, it'd be so easy to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
But this goes further.
Oh, definitely. One of the things, as I was thinking about it, I was driving home and I was like, and this is no spoiler, but trust me when I tell you this. I was like, yo, it's not just the physical war for the Planet of the Apes. I know I'm going to get a little pretentious here. That's the word people like to use. But it is the war inside of Caesar to understand that he needs to create the Planet of the Apes. One of the best things about a sequel, and especially it goes with the third ones, this was something that happened in The Dark Knight Rises, where I don't think The Dark Knight Rises compares to the first two at all. But what Rises does well is that it helps elevate The Dark Knight. When you see the aftermath of Harvey Dent and everything, I think what it does well is that it becomes sort of a booster for Rises. It makes the events in Dark Knight seem more important. One of the best things about War is that it makes all of the events from Dawn, the things dealing with Koba and everything, it shows you the repercussions of that. And some may argue, we've seen this already. But it has to. If it doesn't deal with it, then it makes the events in Dawn seem like, whatever. But it's still focusing on the events in Dawn and things that Caesar did that not only elevates that movie, but shows you that it's more than just a physical war. It is literally the internal war that he has to deal with to realize, yo, some decisions need to be made. And we know they are because, you know, five movies follow it.
Yeah.
But decisions that need to be made to lead to what really becomes the Planet of the Apes. It's incredible, dude. It's amazing. You were talking about the humans.
Yeah. Woody Harrelson.
Ooh. That's how excited I am. Woody Harrelson.
Can't keep your ears on.
It's a character. Yeah, I was like, there's a monkey in there. I think it's a monkey. Another monkey who's played by Steve Zahn. He does something like that. That's... I don't want to spoil it. But Woody Harrelson, again, plays the villain in this movie. But he has substance to him. You may not agree with him. There is a point where they give him a very long speech. It's very long. It's like a 10-minute speech.
He gets his Oscar monologue.
Oh, practically. And you're like, I'm with my boy Caesar, but you're making a little bit of... You're crazy, though. But you're making me believe in your craziness.
I mean, all the best villains in movies are ones that you can understand and potentially get behind their cause, at least to an extent.
Yeah, because, you know, it's sort of like a revenge tale that Caesar's going on, and it could so easily just fall into that, but it becomes, again, because of the events in Dawn, a conflict of like, yo, Caesar, you a hypocrite, because you were all about not doing that in Dawn, and now you're realizing that war within you, is that something you need to do? And then you know how these revenge things go. Is he going to get the revenge that he needs? And the way that it plays out is beautiful. It looks beautiful. The fact, like I'm telling you, it's a biblical epic, and I love the way that... Reeves described it. This story arc, especially this final one, is what religions are made of. This is the Moses story that causes people to go back and believe in this religion. This is what the apes in the future will read about and go, yeah, that is this is the Abraham of the apes in a sense.
It's epic.
That to me, yes, is what makes this franchise so great. I'm just sitting there going like, honoring the elders. They kill us! You know what I mean? I don't know. I think it's great. I think it's fantastic. As you know,
you were with it on Cornelius. You were with it on a dramatic level, on an action level.
Spiritual level, boy. I adore this trilogy. I was watching at a certain point going, is this... I'm always super worried with thirds. Because I'm very vocal about how The Dark Knight Rises broke my heart. And since then, I haven't been able to love again. But... this third one really just amended my heart again. It honestly, there's a point in it where I'm watching and I'm going, oh, okay, this is, it's dragging a bit, where it feels like you're in a concentration camp. It feels like the Hebrews in Egypt. It literally gets to that point, and it feels like it's going to trudge along, and then you realize you have to go through that in order to really appreciate the ending. Kind of like Silence a bit, but Silence was one where I know a lot of people didn't feel it was rewarding.
Yeah.
It starts feeling like Silence, where it's just bopping you over your head and it's depressing, but I think it's worth it at the end. One thing I will say in the political spectrum, there is a building of a wall in this movie, and this is something I have to get off my chest. This movie was written before, and he states it a lot, but I have already read the articles where people cannot enjoy the movie without making a political thing and saying, you see, this is exactly the movie we needed in the Trump era.
Right.
As we talked about with It Comes at Night, if the shoe fits, then sure, wear it. But it's not because of that. This is a movie that years from now, there will be somebody else where you can attribute it to. If you're going to time travel and back in time, you brought, I don't know, a laser disc of this movie, you can play it then as well. You know what I mean? It's not specific to that era, and that's what I think makes it well. If it was, then it'd be ugly. It'd be like, eh, it's tacky.
It's that interesting thing where sometimes art reflects the times, and sometimes the times are reflected in art. You know?
Go ahead.
The Handmaid's Tale, I think, is a perfect example of this. Because although I haven't been able to watch the story yet, we have seen a lot of ads for it. And it's about this society that is very controlling of women and restrictive of women and takes away women's rights. And a lot of people are using this as sort of like, this is analogous to what's happening in the Trump administration. But this is another show that was fully in the works well before he got into office. He had his run.
Yeah.
And also it was a show that a lot of people, when it was in development, a lot of people thought that this would be a show in the Hillary Clinton era. But it's always...
oh, how it works, yeah.
It's really funny just because, like, sometimes the times just change and that doesn't necessarily...
Hey, that's karma coming to get you right there.
People are upset. Sometimes it's just the times mold to what's going on. The times, something's in the air and we feel it, but we're not necessarily reflecting it. And it's up to us as an audience to kind of look for it and see that. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes art reflects life, and other times it's life that ends up catching up to what you're making. And that's something that Matt Reeves talked about, and where they had already written it and they're holding the script and it's coming to life. That is scary. And I think that's what makes the movie so good on that level, if that's what you're looking for. But to me, it's all about the story arc for Caesar. I think it's beautifully done. There's a movie earlier on. I don't want to compare it to that, but I've already compared it to Moses. So if you know the story of Moses, I guess that kind of spoils it a little bit. But there's another trilogy that ended earlier this year about a certain character that we've loved for so long. And the way that wraps up, I think this equally, and I mean that, equally compares to that movie, and I love both of them, and they're both in my top 10 of the year. So,
there we go. I was about to ask how, if this is going to show up easily on your end of year list, think so?
Oh, definitely. I've said this. I'm watching, I'm like, I don't know if it's going to, by the end of it, I'm like, how dare I have it even considered not putting it on? The other two have been, why would not this one be? I honestly, I know some people see them as blockbusters. It is way more than that. This is that perfect, I always talk about balance, is the perfect balance of visuals, perfect balance of story, perfect balance of emotion. It may make you cry at the end of it. I refused to cry for an ape, but man, the fact that it even had me
almost there
is, I have to give it to that. If a movie ever pushes you to almost shed a tear, then it's definitely worth it. I own the first two on Steelbook, both of them, so that shows you how much I love the movies. And I can't recommend it.
Awesome. I wasn't able to check out War for the Planet of the Apes, but I know I will this weekend because I, like you, am a big fan of the previous two. I saw a different kind of monkey last night. I went to the Gorilla Show in Philly. That was fun, but I'm not here to talk about that. I have been watching Take Me. It is a new film from the Orchard studio, and it's directed by Pat Healy, who you may have seen in some things. Hey. He's in Cheap Thrills from a couple years ago. Yeah, he's a very nice guy. I got to actually talk to him a little bit at the Tribeca Film Festival, where this movie had its premiere. It had a small theatrical release, but now it's available to stream through Netflix. It stars Taylor Schilling and Pat Healy as well, doing a double turn as director and star. And it's a really interesting film in which Pat Healy runs a agency that sort of works to create kidnapping experiences for their clients. Let's say that you just want that thrill in your life. Let's say that you think, like, if someone will shock you into not wanting to eat hamburgers again by kidnapping you and force feeding you hamburgers, as they do to Jerry from Parks and Rec in the beginning of this movie, Pat Healy's service is there for you. He plans these organized kidnappings as kind of like a diversion for people. And then he gets a call from Taylor Schilling as a potential client, and it goes further than he's anticipating, but it leads to very, very touchy, strange situations. It's one of those comedies where you don't necessarily know who has the upper hand. They're kind of, it's largely just these two people, Pat Healy and Taylor Schilling, sort of navigating the situation of she's hired him to do a kidnapping, and now he's trying to get through the kidnapping without necessarily having the whole thing blow up in his face. It's not the most hilarious movie. It's very dry in the humor, but it's got some truly awkward, unique, funny situations.
He's good at that.
Yeah, he's got this very awkward energy. I almost feel he's like a more middle-aged Thomas Middleditch, just in his energy. but like, the movie's only 1 hour and 24 minutes long. It's a great, fun little watch on Netflix. I'd absolutely recommend checking that one out. I was able to catch it a couple months ago and saw it again once I saw that it was available to stream. So hopefully you'll be able to check that one out.
Oh, I will. I think those are like the perfect movies to catch on Netflix. Those are the ones I like the most. The ones where it's like at the end of it, it's not like you're probably not going to remember it to be on your top 10 list. But Netflix movies to me are those ones that make you think just a bit, that you enjoy it more. If you would have seen it in the theater, it would have been okay. But seeing it at home, you're like, oh, this is the perfect place.
Exactly. It's not. Some of these movies aren't necessarily like you want to take you and your friends out and spend a lot of money.
But $12.
Take Me is a great discovery movie. It's like, what is this? And you put it on and you're just kind of wowed by how interesting it is. It's not a huge movie. Like I said, it's mostly just these two people talking to each other and navigating the situation. But it's really, really delightful. So I highly recommend Take Me on Netflix.
Good. I had no idea it even existed, so thanks for...
Of course, that's what we're here for.
And hopefully you guys now know too.
Yeah. But we move on to Yay or Nay, the segment where we give our approval or disapproval on the latest in the entertainment.